So welcome to the second part of these lectures on the intertwinings of Monte Carlo techniques and optimization techniques. So in this second part, we can more or less forget what we said this morning, just to concentrate on one thing, which is what I call the convergence of adaptive, or sometimes we speak also of controlled Markov chains, which means that we are in the following situation. We produce, so we have a family of transition kernel indexed by some parameter theta, which may be of finite or infinite dimensional, And what we do is that we, starting from a point x0, we arrive at point xt, and the next point is obtained by choosing in the family the transition kernel indexed by the current value of some random process theta t. And we define the transition mechanism from xt to xt plus 1. Theta t, this morning I gave some examples on how we can define such theta t. This afternoon we will forget how it is defined. We will just have in mind that in the simplest case for this study, in the simplest case, theta t may be learned totally independently of the point xt. It is defined, it is an auxiliary process, and it is used just to feed the mechanism of production of the points. But in the more complex situation, and this morning it was this situation, in a more complex situation, theta t depends on the past behavior of the mechanism. In this second situation, be careful that the sequence of point xt is no more a Markov chain. It is a chain, but not a Markov chain, because the conditional distribution of xt plus 1 given the past is this one. So f is a test function, bounded, if you want. We have this formula with theta t, which may depend on all the past x0 until time t. So we have this framework. So more precisely, we will consider that we have a bivariate process, xt, theta t. We are interested this afternoon in the asymptotic behavior of xt, given that xt is produced by this mechanism and all the transition kernel p indexed by theta are in some family. I will insist a lot just to show you the what happens when we want to study this kind of mechanism. I will insist a lot on the convergence in distribution of xt, what kind of sufficient conditions on the transition kernel, on the way to define theta t, what kind of sufficient condition in order to observe the convergence in distribution of xt. And then I will just give you some insights on how we can prove other limiting theorem like strong law of large numbers or central limit theorem, but I will not detail. I will give you some references. Quite often in mind, and based on the examples I gave you this morning, we will have in mind that theta is in a subset of a finite dimensional space, but it's not at all always the case. And most of what I will say this afternoon still remains valid when theta is, for example, homogeneous to an empirical distribution. I will give you an example, so it may be totally larger than the finite dimensional case. I conclude this morning by an example showing you that even if the example was saying that even if there exists a distribution pi such that for all the kernel p indexed by theta, pi is invariant, all the kernels are invariant with respect to pi, so they all share the same invariant distribution, it may happen, if we have this kind of adaptive mechanism, it may happen that xt converges in distribution to something, but this something is not pi. This was my example in the conclusion this morning, which means that if we want, because in the Monte Carlo context, we are interested in designing transition kernel having pi as invariant distribution, but producing a sequence of points having pi as limiting distribution. So we need some sufficient conditions on this adaptation here mechanism in order to ensure that this mechanism will not destroy the convergence to pi. In the literature, so what I will say this afternoon, the works are about, it was in the past 10 years, it's not exactly recent, but is still used. In the literature, you find essentially three conditions. The first condition is that all the kernel you have admits an invariant distribution. In the context of MCMC sampler, it's not a difficulty because usually we start from a given distribution and we design a kernel having this invariant distribution. So in our MCMC context, this first condition is not difficult. We are able to address the situation when each transition kernel has its own invariant distribution, so more general than this one. Second assumption. The second assumption after Jeff Rosenthal and Gareth Roberts is called the containment condition. Containment condition tells you that all the transition kernel in your family, Pθ, have the same ergodic behavior. So what does it mean, this quantity? It means that when you compare, it means that when you compare the distribution of a Markov chain run always with the same transition kernel indexed by theta, r times after r iterations, when you compare the distribution of this Markov chain started from x to its invariant distribution, compared in a distance which is here is the total variation distance, when you compare them, it has to decay at a geometric rate. Rho is lower than one, between 0, 1. So, and what is quite strong in practice is this uniform condition here, that is, you require that all the transition kernels in your family have the same control and, more difficult, have the same geometric rate. In practice, how do we check this condition? In practice, and in the MCMC context, for example, to prove this kind of condition, we usually use, first, we establish what we call here a Lyapunov drift inequality, which means that we have to find a function V, a Lyapunov function, in such a way that one iteration of the Markov kernel, after one iteration, the value of V, the mean value, for people who are not familiar, Pθ V applied to the point X is the expectation of a chain starting from point X of V of X1 when X1 given X0 is sampled from the kernel Pθ. So here what I say is that the mean value of V after one iteration decreases by a factor lambda. Lambda is between 0, 1. Lambda V, so that there is a decay up to some constant, but V usually is a function that tends to infinity, which means that outside some roughly compact set, this decay is strict. PV is lower than lambda V. Lyapunov drift condition combined with what we call here a minorization condition, that is, we have a for people who are familiar with this notion, a small set or a petit set. So if we have this minorization on some level set of the Lyapunov function plus this drift inequality, there are many results in the literature that gives you the expression of a constant C here, depending upon theta, a rate rho here, depending upon theta, as a function of lambda, B, delta, and essentially these quantities. After that, you are able to check if all these quantities can be chosen uniform in theta when theta evolves in this big theta set. So the first step is to prove this. The second step is to show that the consent can be uniform. And I would say that in practice, except, so if theta is a subset of RP, except when theta is compact, it's quite difficult to show this uniform in theta ergodicity condition. So after that, motivated by many applications when you cannot ensure that you will produce, for example, a sequence of theta t that will remain in a compact set, if you are not able to prove that, you may be interested in more general conditions, ergodicity conditions, and you can find in the literature, you find in the literature this kind of marginal ones. That tells you more or less the same thing, but a lighter condition. The same thing that tells you that you compare the along the path here, you compare the distance between an iterated of the kernel after r iteration compared to its invariant distribution in total variation norm, and you allow the r to depend to epsilon, and so you want a decay, not a strict decay, but a decay in expectation. The advantage of this second condition, and it was used like that in the literature, is that it may allow situations when you are not able to prove that theta t will remain in a compact set. Typically, what was shown in the example of the Ario-Saxman-Biola Hastings-Metropolis algorithm, that is the Hastings-Metropolis algorithm in which the proposal is Gaussian and you try to learn the perfect covariance structure of the Gaussian. For this algorithm, you cannot prove that the empirical estimator of the covariance matrix remain stable. But you can establish a rate showing that the norm of this matrix doesn't increase at a higher rate than t power something. You are able to control as a function of t the rate of growth or a maximal rate of growth of your parameter. And so by allowing the control here to depend on t, you can try to using the fact that theta t increases in a controlled way, you can show that the constant here increases, they increase in a controlled way. And so at the end, you can choose r here, the rate, in such a way that it depends on t, and globally, it is lower than epsilon. So it is a bit more complex, but it allows to avoid the compactness condition of the parameter theta t. So this was the containment condition. Containment meaning that all the kernels have more or less a similar ergodic behavior. The third condition, the last one to prove the convergence in distribution, the third condition is the diminishing adaptation condition. So here again, if you are in the situation when you can prove the uniform in theta ergodic condition, the previous one, the strongest form of the previous one, in that case, a sufficient condition is to say that the way you adapt the mechanism you use to adapt the parameter, here you have a condition on this mechanism, it tells you that two successive kernels, when you compare the kernel index by theta t and the kernel index by theta t minus one, you compare them in a distance which is the total variation distance, you consider the supremum for all the initial values, the possible initial values. So if you, this quantity goes to zero along the path in expectation, then it is what is called the diminishing adaptation. Diminishing adaptation, yes. So if you don't have in the previous, in the containment condition, if you don't have the strong one, the strongest one, if you have the weakest one, this condition is relaxed with this one. A bit more complicated, but it's always the same idea. You have to compare how two successive kernel behaves in the sense of this metric between the command. Here again, in practice, in the context of adaptive MCMC, how this condition is verified. People try to, they start from the expression of the kernel as a function of theta. They try to write, to show a kind of Lipschitz behavior of this quantity, showing that it is upper bounded by a constant multiplied by the difference of the norm, if it is a vector, a norm of theta minus theta prime. And typically for the adaptive Hastings metropolis sampler, this is the case. And if theta t is an empirical matrix, theta t minus theta t minus one behaves like 1/T. So it will behave to the, it will converge to zero, and this condition will be satisfied up to some control of the moment of xt. So in, once you have this upper bound, after that you replace theta, theta and theta prime by theta t minus one. You express this difference as a function of, you replace them by the definition, and in the situation where it depends on the point, on the path of the algorithm, you, to check this condition, you have to check moment condition on the, on XL. So now that you have these three conditions, existence of an invariant distribution, similar ergodic behavior of all the kernels in the family, a mechanism of adaptation which is diminishing a long time, you can prove that the distribution of XT will converge. Will converge to what? First situation, the easiest situation, all the kernels in your family share the same invariant distribution. In that case, what you can prove is that the distribution of XT converges to pi. So here, this morning, one of the three sufficient conditions were didn't hold. It was the diminishing adaptation one. They are all ergodic, they have all the kernels of an invariant distribution, but the diminishing adaptation was not true, and so we cannot apply this result to show the convergence, unfortunately, because the convergence doesn't hold. So this was the problem in my example this morning. Let us prove. Let us prove this result, because it's not too difficult. So what we do, so remember that the mechanism is that xt to xt plus 1 is to use a kernel indexed by the current value theta t. So the expectation of f xt minus the integral of f under pi, so all the kernels have pi as invariant distribution, we are in this situation. You write it, you compare this, the distribution of xt, to a chain, so theta t minus r, and you decide not to adapt during r iteration. That is, in some sense, you freeze the adaptation mechanism. You use the same kernel from time t minus r until time t. Same kernel r times, plus the same thing minus pi of f. So you want to upper bound this quantity to show that it converges to zero. So you will compare the first log here, plus for the second one, you put the f is a, okay. Let us observe the second part because it is the easiest way, the easiest part, sorry. So here, f, we consider a bounded function. And so this quantity is upper bounded by the supremum for all functions which are bounded, let's say by one, multiplied by the supremum norm of f of P theta t minus r applied to g xt minus r minus pi of g. Here, what I prepare is the use of the total variation norm between one kernel, if it is possible to have a supremum in theta, as it is the case in the strongest form of the containment condition. So if we have a supremum in theta of this, in that case, we have xt minus r minus pi in total variation norm multiplied by the supremum norm of f. And if you are again allowed, if you can upper bound uniformly in x, maybe I forget somewhere here. If you can upper bound in x, here you have an assumption. Sorry, I forget the supremum. Supremum in x, theta, supremum in x. So here we have this assumption that tells you that this quantity goes to zero when r tends to infinity. So you can make this block as small as you want, smaller than epsilon, by choosing r as a function of epsilon. Now r is fixed by this second block, and now we will have to choose t going to infinity for this fixed value of r in order to show that this first block is as small, is a small, smaller than epsilon. So here what we do, here we will use the diminishing adaptation, because remember that the expectation of f of xt by conditioning is the expectation of p theta t minus 1 f xt minus 1. So for the first block, we have to compare the expectation of f xt minus what happens when, starting from t minus r, you use the kernel at that time iterated r times. And here you use this decomposition. I write it and I comment. J going from 1 to r minus 1 of the expectation of the kernel theta indexed by t minus r plus g minus p theta t minus r applied to theta t minus r iterated r minus 1 minus j f x t minus r plus j. Let us comment this formula. So let us start in the case, in the sum, the upper index, when g equal r minus 1. Here what we have in that case, we have the quantity which is p theta t minus 1 f of t minus 1. This is minus p theta t minus r f x t minus 1. The expectation of this quantity is this term. So here the first term we have is this one. This quantity here, its expectation, this quantity, the conditional, the expectation of this is also the expectation of p theta t minus 2, p theta t minus r, f x t minus 2. Now, if I observe the second term in the sum, the second term is the sum is exactly equal to p theta t minus 2 P theta T minus R F of X T minus 2, and so on. So this term here cancels with the first one of the previous index. And then at the end, if we observe what happens for G equal 1, the last term we have here for G equal 1 is exactly P theta T minus R iterated R minus R times F X T minus R plus 1. And the expectation of this term is exactly this one. What is the interest of this decomposition? When F is bounded, this quantity is bounded, which means that this distribution applied to this function can be upper bounded by the total variation norm of this quantity multiplied by the infinite norm, the supremum norm of this function. And so here, what appears as an upper bound of each term of the sum, what appears is the total variation norm of between the supremum in X of two kernels, the kernel indexed by T minus R plus G, and the kernel indexed by theta T minus R. And this was a condition appearing in the diminishing adaptation condition here. If they are not, if the index, in the index are not successive, you can after that say that it is upper bound by the sum of two successive ones to use the previous one. So you see the, where we use the ergodicity condition and where we used the fact that when T gets large, two successive kernels behave similarly in such a way that the distribution of XT conditioning to what happens R slots before can be compared to the transition kernel R times before iterated R times. In the literature, we also have results in situations where each kernel has their own distribution. In that case, here, you had a third term in your decomposition, the difference between pi indexed by theta t minus something. And so you need an assumption. For example, if you are able to prove that the sequence of distribution pi indexed by theta t converges weakly, almost surely, to some distribution pi, then in that case, the limiting distribution is pi. In practice, this morning we saw an example. The adaptive importance sampling by Wang Landau approach was an example of adaptive mechanism in which each transition kernel has its own invariant distribution. The theta t were updated by a stochastic approximation scheme. And so in this example, in the Wang Landau, we are able to show that pi in this morning was pi indexed by theta star. We are able to show that the difference in total variation norm between these two distributions is upper bounded by theta t minus theta star. And then we use result on convergence of theta t to theta star to show that we have the weak convergence of this distribution to pi theta star. So this is a result. And finally, there is a more complex situation. It is the situation when each transition kernel, we know that they have an invariant distribution, because I don't know, it is aperiodic, phi reducible, it checks some drift condition, blah, blah, blah. So we know, we are able to prove that some invariant distribution exists, but unique and is unique, but we are not able to have its expression. So it may be difficult in that case to check that the associated invariant distribution converges weakly to something. So what we addressed with Eric Moulin, that will be there this week, what we did with Eric Moulin and Pierre Prioret, is to try to find simple condition on the transition kernel, because all the information that we have in practice is in MCMC is in the transition kernel. So to find sufficient condition on the transition kernel, ensuring that the associated invariant distribution will converge weakly to something. So what we did to that is that to prove that we wrote this decomposition. We want to show a weak convergence of this distribution to, let us say, pi index by theta star. So we first compare this quantity to an iterated of the kernel. Same thing for the other part. And in the middle, we have the difference of two iterateds of the kernel. The blue terms here, the two blue terms, will be controlled by ergodic condition on the kernel. So it's not a problem. It will be small by using this ergodic condition. The most difficult part and the most technical part is to show that almost surely there exists, because the theta t is random, don't forget, so you want to prove this convergence almost surely. So there exists an almost sure set, a set of probability one, so that for all omega in this set, this quantity here goes to zero when t tends to infinity. Starting from, we would like to start from this very light assumption, or light, say, quite explicit assumption on the kernel. Explicit assumption that tells you that given a point X, given a set A, you have the almost sure convergence of this real sequence of numbers to this quantity. That is, you allow the almost sure set here to depend on X and A. This is a very weak condition, and you want to move from that kind of condition to something where omega here is independent of everything, independent of X, independent of A, independent of K. K is countable, it's not a problem, but X and F, it may be a bit more difficult. So in practice, the sufficient condition we provide are the following. First here, to remove the dependence of the almost sure set in A, we use techniques based on the fact that the sampling space is a separable metric space. Let us say that we have a countable family, a dense family, so let us say a Polish space. Then the second thing is to say that we want to remove the dependence in X. So here, again, we will use the fact that we have a Polish space as to use the fact that there is a countable family, and then after, of point X, and then after we have to compare a function at any point X to a point X which is in this countable family, and for that we use an equicontinuity assumption on this family of function. So here we were able to remove the dependence of the almost sure set in X. And finally, if we have for the one iterated kernel, by an induction, we prove that we have it for any K iterated kernel, for fixed K, and this K is countable. From here to here, it's not difficult to move by using an additional property of Fehler properties of the kernel. So we start from a simple condition on the transition kernel, moving to almost sure convergence of their invariant distribution, almost sure weak convergence, sorry, of their associated invariant distribution. So what I show you, these three conditions and these technical details on the different situation for the invariant distribution of the kernels in the family, extend classic conditions. So they extend first, they allow each kernel to be geometrically ergodic, but not necessarily uniformly in theta. This is the first improvement. Then they also allow each kernel to have their own invariant distribution, explicitly known or not. So this is the second extension with respect to standard result. Standard result means the first ones, which are the result by Jeff Rosenthal and Garrett Roberts. then I never use the fact, at least when all the kernels share the same invariant distribution, here in this, the proof which is on the here on the blackboard, what you see that I never use the fact that theta t converges. I just have to say that theta t is such that two successive values are close, but I must, it's not required first to prove as a preliminary step that the sequence of theta t converges. So this is an important remark also in the way you will prove the result. And finally, here again, since here we are able to address the case where we don't have a uniform theta ergodic behavior, we are not obliged first to prove that the sequence of theta t is stable, that it remains in a bounded or compact subset of something. After that, so I detailed what happens for convergence in distribution. There is this result for the strong law of large numbers and for the central limit theorem. All the examples I gave until now were examples where the parameter theta is in RP. Typically, this morning it was a weight sequence in the Wang-Landau algorithm. In the adaptive Hastings metropolis, theta is a covariance matrix. So we have many situations in mind where theta is in RP, let us say, or subset of RP, but in finite dimension space. But there are more general situations, and I wanted to show you this kind of situation. So, which means that in practice, it's a bit more complicated to prove these conditions, but it can be done. And the example is the example is called a sampler which is called the adaptive equi-energy sampler. So, the equi-energy sampler was proposed a long time ago by Ku Zhu Wong. And this algorithm shares three properties. It is interacting, which means that we will run many chains in parallel. We are interested in the only in one, and we will use all the parallel chains as auxiliary quantities. Interacting, tempering, because all the parallel chains are designed to target tempered version of the target of the distribution of interest, and they are adaptive, I will show you. So what we do is that in this equi-energy sampler, the situation is the following. Let I describe the case of two levels, and after that we can repeat. Assume that we would like to sample under this bimodal distribution. A classical algorithm is not able to do that efficiently because it's not able to jump from one side to the other one, blah, 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 the classical stuff. So what we do is that we use, here, if it is a two level, we use a single auxiliary process, which is pi, a tempered version of pi, pi power something, which means that the landscape is smooth enough so that a classical Hastings metropolis, for example, works easily. So we produce points targeting this auxiliary, this tempered version, and now we will define, using these points, we will define a second process, X number two. X number two, a second process that will target pi. To do that, we use a combination of two strategies. With probability 1 minus epsilon, we decide to run, where is it? We decide here to run a classical MCMC targeting pi, which means that we, in that case, we are more or less running a local move, because we know that the classical MCMC is not able to jump, so we are in a local exploration of the space. And with probability epsilon here, we decide to jump to a point of the auxiliary process. The auxiliary process was able to move everywhere. So if we decide to jump to one point of the auxiliary process, it may help to move, to be able to go from the left to the right. But of course, this mechanism has to target pi. So when we pick one of the points of the auxiliary process, We choose one point and we add after that an acceptance rejection mechanism in order to be sure that the transition kernel will have pi as Hessian distribution. And this acceptance rejection mechanism, to make it quite high, because if the probability to accept is always close to zero, you will never accept this auxiliary point. So to make it quite high, what you do is that when you choose one point of the auxiliary process, you choose one point having a similar energy level than the current one, which means that the current state, for example, is here. You first define a partition of the energy level, and you decide to pick one point of the auxiliary process having the same energy level, the same meaning in the same stratum. How to define the strata? It is the most difficult part of the algorithm and the choice of epsilon also, but how to define the strata? So in the equine, the original algorithm, it was not, it was commented, but there was no strategies. And what I did with Eric Moulin and a student, what we did is that we proposed to define the strata as quantiles of the target distribution, but the quantiles are not known a priori. And so we have to learn the quantiles on the fly of the algorithm. So in that sense, it is an adaptive equi-energy. For this sampler, what happens is that the mechanism is indexed by a quantity, but the quantity here models all the points of the auxiliary process. So it is an empirical distribution. So it is not in a finite dimensional space. It is a random distribution. So it is a more complex situation, but it can be studied, and this kind of algorithm works. So here I show you on a toy example. The toy example, when you want to sample from this mixture of Gaussian here. So here it was obtained by an AID sampler because it's simple. So you could use an AID sampler. You decide to run an Hastings metropolis. Started certainly in that part, and after some number of draws, you were not able to see, to explore the other components of the distribution. So the Hastings metropolis remains in that component and is not able to jump. And here I apply the strategy I've just developed by using not one auxiliary process, but four levels of auxiliary process. And you see that at the beginning, you have a target distribution which is highly tempered, so you have points everywhere, and then the beta tends to one. And so here you see the successive value, and this one is the last chain, the chain which targets pi, and you see hopefully that it's better this scheme than this one. Sure. So in this this example was a case where theta is a homogeneous and empirical distribution. It is an adaptive sampler. We proved we have results on the convergence in distribution. We have results on the law of large numbers. In the case of the non-adaptive, that is the case where the strata are fixed before running the algorithm, there were already results in the literature. And what we did is that we addressed the situation where we learn the how to define the strata. Maybe 5 minutes more. I will discuss, just would like to tell you what exists in the literature now if you want to prove a strong law of large number for the same mechanism, produce point xt by using an adaptive mechanism, this one, p indexed by theta t. So there exist results in the literature, which are conditions a bit more complicated than the diminishing adaptation and the containment condition. I don't write them on the slide. They exist in paper. I can give you the references. But here again, we are able to prove strong law of large number for a large family of functions, not only functions which are bounded, but also functions which increases like a potential function V, V being typically in polynomially increasing functions. And in that case, you need ergodicity not in total variation norm or ergodicity of the kernel, but ergodicity in what we call the V norm, which generalizes the total variation norm. And after that, there is a central limit theorem. I will conclude just by telling you, because I will use this tomorrow, the same tools, telling you how, what is the idea when we want to prove limit theorem, such that central limit theorem or strong law of large numbers for this kind of adaptive chain. The technique relies on the Poisson equation. I'm not sure everybody is familiar with the Poisson equation. That is, if assume that we would like to prove a strong law of large number. Let us consider this thing. Une probability for a weak one, or almost surely for a strong one, we would like to prove that it converges to this quantity in the situation when all the kernel in your family share the same invariant distribution. We are able to consider more general case, but let us say that we are in this case. What we do is first condition so that a solution to the Poisson equation exists. What is the Poisson equation? Given a function f, it is a function f hat indexed by theta, satisfying the equation this function minus the kernel applied to this function equal f minus pi of f. And if you have the conditions ensuring the existence of this series, the solution to the Poisson equation is given by as this expression. It is the kernel p theta iterated n times minus pi, the common invariant distribution, applied to the function f. So you have to ensure that this sum exists, and typically, if each kernel is geometrically ergodic, if f is bounded, let us say, if each kernel is geometrically ergodic in total variation norm, in that case, this series exists, and the Poisson equation exists. What is the interest of that? Is that you are close here to define a martingale increment. Just to tell you that if we want to prove a strong law of large number or central limit theorem for this kind of points, you use the Poisson equation in order to apply results for strong law of large number and central limit theorem of martingales. You apply the condition in the literature, and you saw that your quantity of interest is 1 over 2 a martingale plus something which is negligible. So the transformation is the following. We have this sum, f of xt minus pi of f, sorry, like that. So we can write it like that. Here we replace by the Poisson equation. F of xt minus pi of f is f at, we will use theta t minus 1 of xt minus theta t of xt minus pi theta t of at xt. sorry, minus one, I will use this one. Yes. And here you don't have exactly the martingale increment, because if you do the this quantity, if you compute the conditional distribution given the past of this quantity, it is at f. This quantity is in this sigma field, here you have the kernel t minus 1 in x t minus 1. You don't have it, but it doesn't matter. You force the martingale increment. And after that, you observe the remainder term. So you force the martingale increment. And you have an additional term, which is p theta t minus 1 at f theta t minus 1 x t minus 1 minus p theta t minus 1 at f theta t minus 1 x t. So here you decide to put t and to compensate by plus theta t at f theta t x t minus p theta t minus 1 at f theta t minus 1 x t. You have three terms. The first one will give you tends to zero by using arguments on martingale. The second one, what will happen? The second one, but you see that is it is a collapsing sum. If you forget the 1 over t, it is a collapsing sum, so that remains the first and the last term. Divide by 1 over t, it is negligible. There are some moment conditions, sure, but this is a roof ID. It will be negligible. And the last one, why will it be negligible? It will be negligible because it is a quantity indexed by theta t minus a quantity indexed by theta t minus 1. And here, you will say that it becomes negligible because you have the diminishing adaptation assumptions, which will give you that this term disappears at the rate at divided by 1 over t, it disappears. So this is the idea when you want to prove the strong law of large numbers. And this is the same idea when you want to prove a central limit theorem. I will stop there. Thanks.